What is up, everybody? My name is James D. Fiore. I just bit my tongue. That's awesome. Good start, James. And this is Black. My guest today, I have described him as being a person who has had like a front row seat to like the starting point of the golden era. And not only did he have a front row seat, but he was like part of the mechanism that created that golden era to begin with. Like he was one of the bricks. And there is a quiet respect that I have for him because of also who his brother is and how that can seem like an imbalance, but often it isn't. So without all that, welcome to the show, please, Mr. DJ Kenny Parker. Kenny, how are you, buddy?
How are you today? Thank you for having me.
No problem. Thank you for coming.
Yes.
I did a deep dive on Kenny Parker because I wanted to see if there was a bunch of stuff that I didn't know. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that I didn't know. There was a couple of things that I knew, such as you have a book coming out. You have a book that's out, actually. Yes. It's called My Brother's Name is Kenny, This True Hip Hop Story Ever Told. Yes. And obviously fans of KRS-One are going to be like, crazy. This is the behind the curtain stuff that we really want to like learn about people. So what brought on the book?
Well, first, I consider myself a student and a fan of hip hop, a true fan. And I study everyone's stories over the years. I've watched all the movies, I've saw all the interviews, and most people's stories start with, I was a drug dealer, I was a criminal, or I just got out of jail, and then I decided to become a rapper. I'm like, okay. And then after 50 Cent came on the scene and he got shot 9 times, I think it was. Then after that, everyone got shot. That was the story. Yeah. So I'm like, everybody? Okay, this is what we're selling? Okay. So I'm like, well, I'm from the same hood that a lot of these rappers are from. And no one ever tells the story from the other perspective. Like, what about the kid who wasn't in a gang? Who didn't rob anybody, who was mild-mannered, who played sports, who went to the library, who did well in school. No one ever tells that perspective of growing up in the hood. And then the amount of hardships that we went through just to get to where we were trying to get to was unbelievable. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, I want to tell a different perspective than what everyone else is saying, because honestly, I think a lot of people are exaggerating, but you know, that's neither here nor there. But I want to tell a real true story of growing up in New York City when it was the crime capital of America.
You froze there, Kenny. Hopefully you'll unfreeze in a second.
No.
I'm just going to wait it out.
Okay. I'm moving around right now. Can you hear me?
Yeah. It's okay. Yeah, I'm going to toss you back and then toss you back in. It didn't toss you back. Are you there? You're good, right? No, I can't hear you. Why does this always happen to us? Kenny and I tried to do this at an interview a couple days ago. There's that. Okay, here we go. This is better. Kenny, there you are, right?
Yes, sir.
I there's something going on with the software. This has never happened, but whatever. It's happening, and now I'm dealing with it.
We're gonna make it happen, though.
Yeah, the idea. I think that is an interesting perspective because you're right. And it turned a lot of like I'm from Canada. I'm obviously a white dude, and like the suburbs were like crawling with people who were so enamored with the like, you know, the darker socioeconomic side of like hip hop and the street stuff. That we, when like, you know, we were emulating stuff that we, you know, had no business emulating, basically, right? Like it was a weird thing, but it's neat hearing it from that perspective, because even when I was looking at interviews and just trying to figure out who you were as a person, often you would talk about how like these different chapters near the beginning of your college career were like phone calls to KRS-One to see what he's doing. And it was just like an aside that was accepted that, oh, I was in college. So obviously I'm not going to be where he was at, you know?
Right. Well, yeah, that's true. Actually, me going to college is another whole saga that I wrote about in a book. But I went to college on an athletic scholarship to play basketball. And when we were growing up, my passion was sports and his passion was hip hop. And we both were chasing our passions side by side, trying to get out of the hood, so to speak. And yeah, so by the time KRS-One finally broke, well, Boogie Down Productions, I was in college. And but I saw the whole thing firsthand. It was unbelievable to watch my brother become this worldwide icon. It's amazing.
Yeah, and it's like, and you were raised, you were saying, on like reggae music, and I heard you say once too that like, is KRS-One the first one to sort of mix hip hop and reggae?
Yes, as we know it. I mean, there were a couple of groups. I think the Fat Boys did a version, but it was more like a parody what they were doing, like, you know, like trying to dress up like Rastas, and you know, it was more like a joke. KRS-One was the first one to actually mix hip hop and reggae and chat reggae over hip hop beats in hip hop at the way we know it today. He's the first. And that goes back to our childhood of Bob Marley. Yes.
Everything's frozen.
Uh-oh.
I don't know who's frozen. One of us you're on full screen. I put you on like minimize like three times.
You look fine to me.
Then it must be on my end. I'm in a town called Creemore. I'm just going to keep talking as if it's not doing all the things that it's doing, because I'm in the sticks in Ontario, and the internet is fine until the day I had to interview you. Then only when I interview you.
Of course. That's how it goes.
So what was your upbringing like? Like you lived on Sedgwick, right? Like you kind of bounced around a little bit. Was it Love's Gonna Get You? Was that your upbringing?
You know, yes, like, actually Love's Gonna little Get You is actually
what it was like in your house.
Love's Gonna Get You was actually a glamorized version of how poor we were. We lived in Sedgwick Avenue. Actually, amazingly, we lived in the next building from Cool Herc. And on August 11th, 1973, when he had that infamous party that created hip hop, we lived in the next building over from him. I was 7 years old on that day. But we actually used to play in front of Cool Herc's building every single day. So we probably bumped into Cool Herc as kids. I mean, I don't remember him. I was little, but we were in front of his building on the day that hip hop was created. So we were actually there from day one. But we grew up very poor, dysfunctional family, broken home, child abuse, any statistic that you would think of that you would say these kids aren't going to make it, we were in that statistic. And somewhere out of that, right, we still managed to navigate our way. And, you know, I was an honor roll student, but my brother was like a delinquent. So, you know, he was, you know, so watching him, that's why, you know, that's one of the reasons why I wrote the book, because I wanted people to understand where we were and where he was as a kid. So when you see the transformation to what he became, it's almost unbelievable. And I wanted to inspire people to say, well, even though you come from humble beginnings, you too can reach a place if you believe.
Yeah, and it's such a good message too. And does it bother you a little bit that KRS is kind of known as one of the, like, he's known as like a lot of things, but one of them is definitely like a conscious rapper, because you're like, I'm the smart one, man. Fuck.
No, actually, he was very smart.
You could tell he's smart
about school. Yeah. He just didn't care about school. So, you know, the teachers had him pegged almost as like a special education student. And I used to be screaming at the top of my lungs, no, this guy is brilliant. But he would get all F's and D's in school. So, you know, it's because he was uninterested in the school.
KRS One just had to apply himself. That's all it was.
Basically, yes.
Sorry, I got the same speech and the same grades. So
right. But he was like a terrible student. Then he dropped out. So it was just.
And his story, like, I like rappers back. The only backstories, well, I shouldn't say that. I guess I like a lot of different athletes' backstories, especially if it's like, you know, rags to riches types thing. But like, you know, the backstory of KRS-One is pretty epic. Like, he and you guys as a family didn't know where he was for a couple of years because he was basically bouncing around or staying at nights in the shelter and stuff like that, right?
Yes. Yes. Well, he had been living on the streets off and on since he was like 13. So he'd be home sometimes, he'd run away, he'd come back, the police will bring him back, he'd run away again. So by 15, 16, he was gone officially in the streets. Me, I eventually, due to circumstances, became homeless, a homeless teen as well. And so we basically were both living in shelters as a teen. But then through sports, I was able to go on to college. So I kind of got out of the hood through sports.
What was the sport?
Basketball.
Okay, good. Yeah, yes. that's a good way to get out.
I got an athletic scholarship to St. Peter's University. Shout out to them for making the greatest NCAA run of all time this year. Just had to give a quick shout
out. There you go. Yep.
So while I was off, went away to school in New Jersey, he disappeared. For a couple of years, I didn't know where he was. I thought he was dead. And then he reappears with a new single, South Bronx.
Does he ever say like what he did? Like you know, there's that famous story. I can't remember who the guitar player was, but they were okay. They were like a session musician. Then he went away for a year and a half and came back. And he said he made a deal with the devil to give him
right. The best. Oh, yeah, that was Robert. Oh, goodness. Robert Johnson, this great guitar player, the father of blues.
That's right.
No,
that's right.
Chris was gradually, I'm calling him Chris, KRS. Chris, yeah. I call him my brother. No, he was gradually progressing as the years went by. But then there was a gap. By 84, he was already a dope MC.
He invented a genre too, in a sense, the boom bap.
He really invented a couple of genres. I mean, the battle genre he created with the whole battle with MC Shan and the Bridge Is Over.
Yeah, I guess he was right around the first, right? This is what you're talking about,
yeah? Yeah. Yes, that was the Bridge Is Over is the first battle record.
Yeah. Is it really? I just thought that is right too, because Kumo D and those guys battled back then.
Yeah,
we used to have to get the tapes from relatives in New York that would ship them to Canada. You know, it was really hard. Toronto had a really good hip hop scene. I don't know if you knew
that. Yeah, I remember we did many shows in Toronto. Love those shows.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kumo D versus Busy B. That battle happened in the end of 81. And that was only on cassette. So that was the biggest known battle in hip hop.
That was like the first MC battle, because you guys, there was always like dance battles and shit like that, right?
Well, they had like, you know, Cold Crush versus the Fantastic Five or the Furious Five versus these guys on cassette. So guys were battling, but the Kumo D Busy B battle was like the first time one guy like destroyed another guy, like Kumo D, in my opinion, destroyed Busy B. Shout out to Busy B, that's my homie. But hey,
back then, was it like, did you have to freestyle, or did people come with prepared lyrics? I've always wanted to know that back then, because I grew up thinking that the only true definition of that word, coming off the dome. If you're spitting something that you've written, then it's no longer a freestyle. You're just spitting something that you've written. And something happened along the way in like the early 2000s where that switched for some reason. Right. And
well, you know, I'm not an MC, so let me say that. But my definition of back in the day, guys wrote. I don't think a lot of guys were just rhyming. When they were rhyming off the top of the head, it was more like, what's your zodiac sign? You know, I'm so-and-so, you know, like, yeah. Who's in the house, ladies, fellas, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But I think when you heard, like, organized lyrics, I would think that they were writing those down. But the word freestyle became...
Because cats that could do it were, like, they were just next-level MCs.
Yes.
Versus the, where I grew up, versus the cats that don't. You could be, like... amazing and like have the best tracks and cipher your balls off, and that's great, but if you couldn't bring it off the dome, you just weren't quite as high as that other rapper. I don't know, for some reason where I live, that was
to me that term off the dome and freestyle, to me that's like a 90s term. To me,
hi, I'm 45.
Yeah, I know, right? I'm a little older than you, considerably. Oh, okay. In the 80s, that term freestyle, I didn't hear it as much as going with off the top of your head. Off the top of your head became more like a 90s thing to me. Before that, even if I say I'm about to freestyle, people would do rhymes that was on records, you know, that would later be on somebody's single, you know.
Yeah, so. It could just be a reflection of how we are in Toronto. We like to complain a lot. Like, we are very complainy. People are like... people in Toronto are so friendly if they're from the States, and we're just like, no, we're just a little passive aggressive and we just want to keep on going with our day. Like, you know, just
we consider Canadians very friendly actually here.
Yeah, but that, I mean, we consider you guys to be scary. Like, just your country is kind of scary. When you elected Trump, we were all like sitting here up here like how bad could it get down there? Like, is this the bottom?
Like, many of us, half of America thought that as well.
But it's amazing that the other half thinks the way, like, it's just weird. And that you can only be in two camps now in politics. Like, you can only be left or right, and that's it. And it's just like, I think people are more thoughtful, you know, they're more complex.
I thought that as well. But now, in America, it's you are either here or there, period.
Yeah. Someone needs to build a centrist party.
That would be fantastic. Call it the thinking party. Yeah. Think, what do you actually think?
Yeah, exactly. Oh, and also my nephew has Boom Bap as his license plate. So
dope. Return of the Boom Bap album.
Yeah. So when you were away, because I'm feeling like the KRS-One connection to hip hop is like a passion and a love. It's ingrained in him. And I feel like you like sort of like came into your own as a man and then attached that mature person to hip hop, and that's how you did it. You came at it from totally different ways. Is that accurate or?
No. We both discovered hip hop at the same time as kids. The difference was that I loved hip hop and I wanted to hear more. I want to hear more. He wanted to be it. So when he heard hip hop, he was like, I want to do this. This is my calling. I was more like, I would love to hear who else is rhyming. I would like to hear them rhyme. I had no intentions of being a rapper or even a DJ growing up, actually. That came later on. But I was always passionate about it, but sports was my number one passion. So hip hop was like second. Yeah. But for Chris, hip hop was the only thing. He had no plan B. There was nothing else.
Graffiti. And the MC Shan thing was actually, wasn't it kind of like, okay, that could have gone sideways pretty quick, couldn't it? Or is it a testament to the culture that it didn't and probably wouldn't have?
You mean
like, I want to be educated about that kind of stuff. I just want to know about the politics.
Violently? You mean violent?
Just violently, because I know that the culture back then, like even the club where it was at was kind of a good choice, right? Because of the diversity.
Actually, hip hop was very violent at that point. And it could have easily gone sideways. Funny enough, MC Shan and KRS were actually friends. Became friends later on. And the beef wasn't even about MC Shan, really. He was an innocent bystander, really. The beef was really with a guy named Mr. Magic, who was a radio personality at WBLS in New York City and the leader of the Juice Crew. And KRS-One and Scott LaRock wanted to join the Juice Crew.
Oh.
And they came to the studio where Mr. Magic was and Molly Mall,
who was
the hottest producer in hip hop at that time. He had just did Eric B and Rakim, Biz Markie, MC Shan, Shantae. He was on fire. So KRS-One and Scott LaRock wanted to be down. They went to the studio and they met Mr. Magic and they played him maybe a demo, or like they had a single out. They weren't even called Boogie Down Productions then. They were called 1241. And they had a single and they played it for Mr. Magic. And he said, "This is trash.
Oh.
You guys are bums. You will never be as good as MC Shan and Molly Mall. Get out the studio," and threw them out.
What? See you in a year, buddy.
Right. So that was in 86. So on the way home from that incident, KRS-One started writing.
That's how you do it. Right. Literally he's born like, out of the energy of being
born
dissed,
out of
right?
the energy of the diss, Mr. Magic. Like, oh, MC Shan is your MC. You think he's the best? Okay, I'm coming.
Yeah. So and in a way, Mr. Magic kind of killed himself.
Yes. Because he was the catalyst to get dissed legendarily by KRS-One, and he could have signed KRS-One if he wanted to that day.
I wonder, though, because this is the way that life kind of messes with my head. Maybe it does the same for you, Kenny. But like synchronicity and life paths. Maybe that incident is what put KRS on the path that made all those great records. Maybe that Absolutely. He needed that, you know, like,
yes. what if
he joined the Juice Crew and it didn't go so well and he was just dancing, wondering why he was up on stage?
Right. At that time, the Juice Crew had MC Shan, Biz Markie, and Roxanne Shanté, and Big Daddy Kane, I think, and Coogee Rap were like in the wings.
Okay.
They were around, but they were like not on yet.
Why is the solo artist back then so difficult to imagine? Like, why is it always crews?
Well, first of all, it was extremely difficult to get on. Mm. You know, not like today. I mean, there was like a handful of labels that made rap records. Most of them were independent. And you had a handful of crews. Like you had like a handful of people controlling the game. So if you wanted to get in the game, you had to connect yourself with the Juice Crew or Rick Rubin, these guys, Run DMC, LL, you know, Russell Simmons, those guys.
Def Jam, yep.
Yeah, or maybe Herbie Lovebug had like Salt and Pepper and Dana Dane and these guys. It was like a handful of crews that was controlling New York City. So you wanted to be down.
Yeah. And then Native Tongues after that.
Yeah. After that. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. There was so much good hip hop back then. Like my nephew is like 31 and he always once a year, he's like, the perfect years to be born in as far as good hip hop goes is between 72 and 78. Like if you're born in that area, then that means that you experienced the best hip hop at the best age. And I'm like, I don't think I can argue with that.
I will attest to that. Yeah, I mean, everything was so new.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like to see a rap video was amazing. To see a rapper on TV and had a video, nobody had videos. You didn't even know what people looked like.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like your favorite rapper could be standing next to you in the supermarket. You wouldn't know what he looked like. That's right. You know what I mean? To finally see, I think Run DMC, well, it was Sugar Hill Gang, really. It had that little cheesy video, but yeah. Run DMC really broke through. They're the ones that broke
LL through. Cool J, too, back then. Had a bunch of guys, too.
Yeah, LL, of course. These guys were so big. They were almost not even real people, you know.
Yeah.
You know, they weren't like, you didn't, even living in New York, you would never think you would see Run DMC or the Fat Boys. The Fat Boys were huge rap group to, you know, you wouldn't.
I know. I had a bunch of their stuff and I was always like, why did they call themselves that? Why didn't they just use a name that had like some longevity power?
You know? I know, right? Well, I think, like, you know what? Actually, they were first called the Disco 3.
Oh, Fat Boys is a step up from Disco 3.
Right. And their single was called the Fat Boys. So it was the Disco 3 made the Fat Boys. And then I remember there was like a contest on the radio. Pick a name for the group. Pick a name for the group. I'll never forget this. And everybody called in and started calling them the Fat Boys.
Oh, that's that was like a preview to what the internet does.
Right. So it was like the call. So they changed their name. This is how I remember. Based on radio people calling in the station.
I guess that's a smart thing to do at the time. But that's the kind of hip-hop that would be at the HMV where I lived. And then we would have to go to record stores in Toronto and get them to order from record stores in New York. And that would take a couple weeks or a month or whatever to get in. It was all the white label stuff. It was like, you know, when all the 12-inch came out, we would just get our hands on whatever we could. I wasn't a DJ, so I just got the tapes and stuff. But you know that you like a culture when you do that kind of stuff in order to just consume it. You know what I mean? Like,
it was very hard. Even in New York City, it was very difficult to hear and get new stuff. That's why when the mix show hit, Red Alert, Molly Mall, Chuck Chill Out, it was unbelievable because you could hear all the songs on one station. All you got to do is press record for us. Press record, Red Alert, you taped the whole show, and then you heard everything. So if Red Alert played your record, you were a superstar to us. Mm-hmm. That was as good as it gets.
I saw another interview with you where you were like, when KRS told you that that he was gonna diss MC Shan, you were like, "Are you sure that's a good idea, dude?"
Yeah, I actually told him, "Are you sure MC Shan is dope?" That was my exact words.
And then you were at college or something, and you were listening to Red Alert, and your brother's song came on Red Alert, and you were like, "Well, it looks like KRS-One has made it." Like,
this is like a week. I mean, I might have got in touch with him after 2 years. Mm-hmm. And like he's telling me like in a few days, we're talking for the first time in like a couple years. Wow. And he's telling me, "Hey man, in a couple days, Red Alert's going to play my record on the radio." And I'm like, "The Red Alert is going to play your record?
You're the best sibling ever."
Yeah.
Like, why would he do that?
Right. I was the first hater. I was his first hater because I was always in his ear. "You can't do that. That's impossible. No way." You know, so for me, like, Red Alert's going to play your record? That's impossible. But sure enough, he played South Bronx that weekend, and it was unbelievable.
And that, what year was that? Because I want to know why you, my question earlier, I asked you sloppily. It wasn't about loving hip hop. It was about being a part of it as an artist, as a DJ. And why that seemed to, like, when did that start? I should just ask. When did that start interesting? Like, when did that start interesting you to like get to that place and then end up becoming a member of BDP?
Well, this happened in 1986, when South Bronx hit. And then by the time I graduated from college in 1989, and I was a avid hip hop fan, and by this point, my brother was working on he had three albums out by this point, so he was already huge. Mm-hmm. And after college, I was going to his house, staying in his house sometimes, and he had all the DJ, he DJs as well, so he had a whole DJ set up and he had all the records. So I asked him to teach me how to DJ just so I wouldn't have to wait till the weekend to tape Red Alert. Because if you missed a song, you had to wait a whole nother week to hit a song. But my brother had all the records and DJ equipment. So I'm like, "Just teach me how to DJ so I can make tapes for my Walkman. That's it." And it just so happens that right at that time, D-Nice, who had to replace Scott LaRock when he was killed, D-Nice was the DJ for Boogie Down Productions, was going solo. And BDP needed a DJ. And it just so happens that here I am just learning how to DJ. And I just kind of slid right into the group. Almost, you know, it was just
it's like your first gig is the DJ for Boogie Down Productions.
My first DJ gig was 5,000 people. And
how'd that go?
It went well. I was terrified. But
Did you find that you were really sound fundamentally? Like you knew how to, you know, like you maybe like where, you know, like because the DJ has to learn how to beat mix. The DJ has to learn how to be like good with timing and stuff on top of the artistry that can go along with that. Did you nail the fundamentals? And that's why it was an easy, because your first gig was BDP 5,000 people. Like,
no, I didn't nail it.
I like how honest you are.
First of all, I was making tapes. So I had been DJing for about 3 months.
Okay.
Just making tapes. I had learned how to cut, scratch, and just make tapes. And then, like, then Chris was like, so we have a show tomorrow in Oakland, California. We're flying out, and you're DJing tomorrow. He didn't ask me, do I want? He said, so you're DJing tomorrow. And so, oh my God, you know.
That's exactly it.
Right.
Yeah.
So he threw me in the fire. So, you know, the next day I was DJing, but I thought it was going to be temporarily, like, okay, D-Nice is leaving. I'll DJ until he finds somebody. Mm-hmm. That's how I was thinking about it. But after the first show, then the second show, third show, next thing you know, I'm DJ Kenny Parker. A week earlier, I was Kenny Parker, just graduated from college.
Yeah.
A week later, I'm DJ Kenny Parker for Boogie Down Productions, and we're about to go on tour.
Yeah.
just like that.
You must have been a good grounding force for him. I might be making a lot of assumptions here, but like, you know, or was it like, come with me, little brother, I'll show you how to tour, you know?
It
like
became that. First of all, me and Chris are only 10 months apart.
Oh, okay.
So yeah. So basically,
but he still rides you for being older, right? Because every sibling I know does that.
He's older than me. I'm the youngest.
Oh, I know. But he probably. Right, right. But he probably uses that. Right.
But no, actually, we respect were almost your elders, equal.
That kind of thing.
Yeah, we were almost. Actually, I was really the lead as a kid.
Oh, right.
I'm the one who he had no friends. I was the one who made all the friends. I was the one who said, "Let's go over here and do this," and I'll bring him. Let's go over here and hang out. I'll bring him. Like, he really followed my lead all the way up until hip hop.
You know, it would be a great show if I could surprise you right now with him so I could watch you guys fight, because that would be amazing.
We had the best fight. Our best debates are over hip hop.
Every best debate is over hip hop.
We've been arguing over hip hop since the very beginning. You know,
what parts do you differ on? That'd be interesting.
He likes his philosophy. Here's how KRS looks at music. Things are either incredible, some of the greatest stuff of all time, or it's trash.
Oh, he's an extremist.
I think, that's how he sees music. Mm. I see music as some things are good. It's not the greatest thing I ever heard in my life, but some artists are pretty good. They're not trash. So if I bring him something, I said, listen to this. I think it's pretty good. And he thinks it's, he's like, nice, whack. So then we'll start arguing. That's not whack. That's dope. You know what I mean? It's like MC Shan. I thought MC Shan was pretty good.
He wasn't just posturing because of the battle that was happening. He legit didn't think he was good.
No, he legit thinks I'm better than MC Shan. Keep in mind, he was living in the shelter when he said this.
But he probably was, because he was hungry.
Well, he was, as it turned out. Yeah. But you know, MC Shan, that song, The Bridge, when it was out in New York City, was one of the hottest records in the city. So when he's telling me I'm about to battle MC Shan, he's still in the shelter. So it's like almost like a homeless guy.
It's like a Rocky.
Yes, absolutely. It was like Rocky. Imagine Rocky with the person going, you can't win. Who is that?
That's like me. Roxanna Shante.
Right. That's me. I'm the one going, you can't win. You can't beat MC Shan. That was me.
Okay.
And I was wrong. But that's most of our hip hop arguments are always, I think something is good and he thinks it's not incredible. And so then we just argue for hours over that. So.
I remember like, I think it was, I don't know, 12 years ago, probably something like that, where they were showing Kanye West and then they cut to an interview with KRS and he's like, we don't wear white shades in hip hop. We don't wear white shades in hip hop. And I was just like, And it was hard not to go like, yeah, because it's KRS-One. I basically agreed with everything that he said when I was a kid. But then I was like, you sure?
It might be okay. You know so what?
White shades, you know?
Actually, Flavor Flav had on white shades in Public Enemy, so.
He's had lampshades on.
Right. I mean, Humpty Hump had, I mean, I don't know. I mean, that's a KRS opinion. You know, like, yeah. Had he said that to me, I probably would have said, but hey, wait a minute. I know somebody who had a white shades, and we would have, you know, we'd have went back and forth. That, you know,
I'm
that
pretty sure Kumo D had white shades in one of his album covers, too.
Kumo D, I don't remember if they were white, but and shout out to Kumo D because he's a good friend of ours. I just want to shout him out. Great guy. But he had a shades. Yeah.
I still know all the words to like How You Like Me Now. I think I still live.
Wow, wow, West. I loved Kumo. And we loved him when he was in the Treacherous Three. And you know, we was glued to the radio. Me and my brother were glued to the radio every day.
He was a technician. He was like his like verses were so like, I don't know. It was like his voice was like, he was almost like the last of that throwback voice, you know, like whatever, like talk about not the great Theo, Tony and Milton like that. He was the last guy that had that style. Right. And then, but he had like new era rhymes though. Like his words were like, they remind me of Big Daddy Kane sometimes, or even Rakim. But they were delivered in that like Houdini way or something. So it was weird.
Right.
It was,
Right. I'm sure that Kane and Rakim were influenced by Kumo D. I mean, everybody coming up was influenced by Treacherous Three, the Cold Crush, you know, shout out to Grandmaster Caz and, you know, the Furious Five. Everyone was inspired by them. Even if you don't realize it in your mind, you're inspired by the guys who came before you.
Oh, for sure. That's one thing. It's just funny because like, I'm a white kid from Canada. My buddy Nigel tells me that my backpack straps are too tight because I get all worked up over like...
Never too like, tight.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I said. And but there's like, you know, this idea that you don't have to know your starting point when you're, you know, and you don't see that in genres like rock and roll. Like I haven't seen like some modern rock and roll guy be like, and you know, fuck the Beatles. Well, I'm right. I just want to say fuck, you know.
No, these guys, a lot of the guys I see now, you ask them, who are your influences? Me. Yeah. You know, who did you like? Me and my clique. That's it. Like, there's nothing.
We have our own language
now.
Right. we mumble a lot and we know what we mean. Yeah.
You know, you don't even know where, like even saying, throw your hands in the air and wave them like you just don't care. That somebody came up with that line.
He was probably sitting there 10 years later going, fucking assholes keep fucking taking my shit.
Everyone in hip hop and in the world goes on tour and says, throw your hands in the air. That's someone's line that influenced you.
Yeah.
But you don't even realize it. It's just so normal. Hip hop is so normal that you don't even think about the influences. But somebody has come up with just about everything that you're thinking, that you're saying.
You can tell when that hip hop is influential. If you can't tell, you should just like when groups like Dos FX came out, and then like a month later, you're on the basketball court. Like we used to do ciphers on the basketball court or in the school locker room or whatever in the cafeteria. But people would be like throwing Dos FX, you know, like slippity dabbity or whatever. Like, they would be throwing that into their rhymes and we'd be like, you are on a 1 week suspension from the cipher. You must leave. Like we were so like militant about, I think we were trying to be like as honest as we could towards the culture because we were so foreign from the culture.
Right. Right.
You know, so.
You know, Dos FX, people bit Dos FX style so bad that they couldn't even come back out with their own style. And then their next album, they sound like they were biting themselves.
Yeah. And Criss Cross is sitting there going, how come nobody else is wearing their clothes backwards? You know,
I wrote Criss. Wow. Criss Cross.
Yeah. There's a, and the territorial thing. I want to talk about that a little bit too, because even New York, it was born out of it. And I get that, but was it like the, I'm from Queens. You're from, you know, where that rock lands. So we can't obviously get along. Like, didn't that become a crutch for hip hop after a while? And then maybe native tongues was sort of like the floaty group that was from maybe those areas but didn't subscribe to the territorial stuff of it?
Yeah, well, let's start with it. Even before hip hop, New York City is very territorial.
Yes.
You know,
I know that. Yeah.
I was born and raised in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. I'm not like those guys from uptown. Like, even Manhattan. Manhattan is considered uptown.
Right.
We are completely different. We consider ourselves completely different. Who? Completely different from Queens. Those guys are over there. So New York has five boroughs. To us, that's like five separate states. Yeah. If you're from Brooklyn, I'm from a different place than you're from Manhattan or the Bronx. And like, even Staten Island wasn't even part of New York to us until Wu-Tang came out. Before Wu-Tang, Staten Island was, we didn't even, Staten Island, nobody lives in Staten Island. That's just a bunch of houses. And then Wu-Tang Clan comes out and we're like, yo, those guys are from Staten Island?
That's you right. Know? Yeah.
Right. But even like Mount Vernon or Yonkers, those are like cities right outside of New York. That's not New York City to us. So they had to fight to get respect. Just Yonkers. And they had like DMX, you know, people like that. They're outside of the city. So
that's like an American thing, I think.
Yeah. So that's how New York looks at itself. Now you take that to hip hop, you know, I'm from Brooklyn, you know, Queens, you know, like when the bridge is over, KRS is like, I'm from the Bronx and we started this. F Queens. You know what I mean? You know, that's his
fuck thing. That place with all those dope rappers come from, but it's right. Not my
place. Right, exactly. And they're like, you know, blah, blah, Queens. You know, so it's just, you know, that's a New York thing. We're very territorial, like extremely.
Yeah. When I wonder if people in Queens, when Do the Right Thing came out, were like, fuck, we don't have a dope movie.
I know. You know, yeah. Wonder what they thought. I mean, you know, Public Enemy, Long Island. Look, Long Island had some of the greatest rappers. They had Rakim, Public Enemy, EPMD, De La Soul.
Yeah, those are Rushmore rappers.
In New York City, Long Island is the suburbs. You guys are over there to us. You know what I mean?
It's like the elitist in Bizarro.
Right. New York is very elitist, almost to a fault.
Almost, yeah.
And, you know, and that was the basis, I think, of the East Coast, West Coast beef was because they felt, West Coast felt like, we accept all New York rappers. You guys come out here, do shows. We play all the records, but you guys don't accept us like that. And that was like the basis of the feud.
Yeah, Puffy's not really likable. You know, he doesn't have he's got a likability problem. You know,
he's very flossy.
Yeah,
and that could rub people the wrong way. You know,
Suge was right about one thing. He didn't. You know, do what other producers did and show up in the video dancing in the champagne room, right?
Like, yeah, I mean, but yeah, he did other things. But
we used to shout at the TV, why is Puffy in this video?
Puffy was like, I'm going to make myself a star.
And he did it. I know.
And he did it. He became a huge, one of the biggest rappers. And he didn't even write rhymes. And he became one of the biggest rappers ever.
I blame the media for a lot of my like animosity towards people like Puff Daddy. I don't know him. I've never met him. Why would I not like him? You know, right. And even the East Coast, West Coast thing. I remember just waking up one day and going, oh, I've just been hating West Coast rappers for the last 6 months for no apparent reason. I'm going to stop doing that because it was in the middle of that. And I realized that I was susceptible to that type of marketing, you know, because the media was all over West versus East versus
all
West.
All over it.
And I just thought of it in terms of music. And I'm like, well, if they're going to make me pick a side, I got to go with the East side, obviously. Like, you know, and then it was like, don't play West Coast shit on your stupid radio show. Then, you know, and then I was like, oh, fuck it. We got to stop doing this. You know,
what's the funniest thing about the East Coast, West Coast beef, as a person who was in the music business, traveled out there and knew all the participants. The West Coast had East Coast DJs on the radio were fronting on East Coast rappers too. Like people in New York were like, these guys suck. That's A. And B, the guys who were the most mad on the West Coast were the handful of guys that got all the play in New York. Tupac, Ice Cube. Dude, their records were on nonstop in New York, and they were the ones that was the most mad.
And I'm not trying to be I'm not trying to be disrespectful to anybody that might hear this one day, but if Too Short was from the East Coast, no one would know who he is. You know, there's certain artists that I was just like, It felt like it was they felt like the throwback rappers. It's like we already did simple rhymes. We did that 10 years ago or something.
Exactly. New York was all about lyrics and who got new styles of lyrics. But in the rest of America, because this is even down south, Midwest, they're more into a feel and the music, and they're more into a feel. So
that's why the East Coast props up the rest of the country.
Right.
We worry about the lyrics.
I'm biased. I'm biased. I'm gonna agree with you. I'm biased. I'm from New York, so I'm biased. But a lot of rappers from the West Coast, lyrically, we didn't consider up to par. But there are some who we liked, like Cypress Hill.
Yeah. It's hard. It would be a difficult discovery to find like five conscious rappers from LA.
Very much so. That wasn't their thing. You know, that just wasn't their thing. Mm-hmm. You know, and you know, we were into conscious lyrics, and that just wasn't their thing. You know, so we took bits and pieces of the West Coast. Like we liked the Chronic. So we know they played, you know, Dreams. That was everywhere. We played the Chronic a lot. Tupac, like I said, a lot. Ice Cube a lot. But if you're like Too Short or like Mac 10 or one of those guys, you have a legitimate beef. They got no play in New York City. Zero. Too Short couldn't get arrested in New York City. If he said, you know, F New York, he is very legitimate to say that. Absolutely Too Short. You feel F New York, you are right, because they didn't play your record at all.
But it's possible they didn't play it because they didn't think it was dope. I'm just saying.
But these guys are going, keep in mind, these guys are going platinum. So like the rest of America, these guys were selling 1 million records and couldn't get arrested in the place that was the main hub of rap. They couldn't get arrested, and they would sell 1 million records everywhere.
I'd like to audit that that platinum designation. Mean, you
know, America is a huge place.
Yes, it is.
You know, and you know, you could sell, I mean, you could be, if you're from Texas and you're talking about Texas things like the Ghetto Boys, if you're talking about the Texas stuff, you could sell a lot of records in the state of Texas. You can go gold maybe in that state.
Yeah, that is a weird thing. And that's what I was thinking about when you were talking about the different boroughs and how everyone sort of like stayed in their borough and played music for their borough. And what I found interesting about that is that if you do that with your audience, if the audience in mind is the very neighborhood that you live in, then the best ones that execute that style of that neighborhood would really shine when they finally are allowed to like spread their wings then, because it's almost like a farm system for rappers.
Right.
You know,
you would think that, but I mean, that's not how it turned out. I saw the Ghetto Boys get booed in New York City with my own two eyes the year before My Mind's Playing Tricks came out. They came to New York to the New Music Seminar. They got booed off the stage. The next year, when My Mind's Playing Tricks on Me, that was a big song in New York. A song comes on, everybody's cheering. The same guys, 1 year later. I mean, that's how it is. New York is a tough place. New York is a tough place to get accepted. I mean, it is what it is.
Yeah, we're like a mini New York. We call Toronto the screw face capital, because we're just like this until you deliver some fire. I know. It is kind of like we're all sommeliers, you know, like we're all the wine experts, except it's hip hop. And we whine about it a lot.
I'm not even saying it because you're, you know, I'm talking to you, but BDP has always been very well accepted in Canada. We've had great shows there. So,
dude, I'm Hamilton. I love Canada. I don't know if you toured with him in Canada before, like with the group, but I'm sure you've toured Canada, you said, right?
In the 90s, early 2000s, yeah.
Yeah. In 2005 or something, KRS-One, I bought tickets to go see him in Hamilton at Pepper Jack. And I did the show, and then I left early because I wanted to say hi to him, but didn't want anybody around. So I found the white SUV, and I just took a shot. It's like, this looks like it might be good.
Oh, yeah,
and it
was.
And he came up, and long story short, I didn't want an autograph or a picture or anything like that, but I was like, can I spit like 16 bars with you? And he's like, yeah, sure, go for it. And I got to spit with KRS-One, and it didn't matter. I didn't even like, you know, it didn't matter. No. I didn't even care if you thought it was good. I always like to tell people that I'm still a practicing MC. I still write lyrics every day. I like rehearse all the time. Dope. In the same way that a guy who still loves basketball will shoot hoops, right?
Right.
Because when I was in my 20s, there's always this thing like, are you going to try to sell it to a record label? And then you would always think in terms of single. It's got to be 3 minutes. And, you know, you got to make sure it's short enough for commercial. And then, like, when you don't think about any of that stuff because you're just making it for your kids.
Right.
Oh, that's where good shit happens.
That's how hip-hop was in the 80s, early 90s. It wasn't single-driven, and it wasn't really a formula. Like, you had to have a hook. No, it has to be this amount of minutes because the radio is going to cut it off after 3 minutes. So it has to be, you know, but as hip hop progressed and got more on the radio, we had to abide by R&B rules. So you want to get on the radio with the R&B songs, you have to have under 4 minutes. You have to have clean versions. You have to have a hook.
Disney tells us to do.
Right, exactly. So, and you know, you want to be famous, so you get with the program.
Yeah. It's funny how much great art can spring out of a nation that seems to always be in crisis one way or another, really.
I think that's the catalyst.
Yeah, I think you're right. And that's interesting on so many levels. I feel like I could talk to you for hours, but we do have to go. Let us know where people can, first of all, get the book. I think I saw this on Amazon, and I'll put a link in the descriptor on there.
Yes, the book is available on all platforms, Amazon, Apple Books, BarnesandNoble.com. Anywhere where you buy books, you can buy the book. I think it's a great read. I go through the whole history of BDP and my family history, because I have to let you know where we came from so you could understand how incredible it is that Chris Parker, myself as well, but Chris Parker became who he became. And so the book is there. It's on Amazon. Please get a copy. I think you'll enjoy it.
All right. Kenny Parker, thanks for joining us, man. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been fantastic.
No problem. We'll do it again.
Yes.
We'll figure out a date and we'll do it again. And maybe you can bring your brother and I can just referee you guys fighting about hip hop for an hour. That'd be dope.
I wish I could tell you the funny conversations we've had over the hilarious.
Yeah. Will he listen to you? Okay, come on a podcast you've never heard of before. It'd be fun.
No, he'll come. If you told him that he will argue about hip hop, that'll make him come.
Listen, you probably have a better relationship with KRS-One. Tell him you guys are welcome to fucking argue on my podcast anytime you want. Seriously. Okay. All right. Kenny Parker, thanks, man. That was fun. We had tech issues again, but I got over it. I don't know if you noticed, but my face went really red and I was just going to like shut down the whole thing. And I'm glad I didn't, because Kenny Parker is a nice man and he is a great DJ and he is in one of the most important hip hop groups of all time. And I love that. Tonight, Darren Frost, comedian, very controversial and funny as hell. So he'll be on at 7:00. So I'm doing two shows today because it's been a slow week. Until then, we will see you next time and see you later. Black, 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 black